There are some filmmakers whose style is so unique they can announce themselves in a scene. With such personal vision, such specificity of time, place, and cultural context, we only need to spend a minute in their world to recognize their signature.
So it'd be quite a coincidence if they weren't, you know, connected.
But then, there is another breed of filmmaker, those who can make themselves known in a single frame. Filmmakers like Roy Andersson. With only 5 features to his name, the Swedish director is a visionary in the true sense of the word. No director shares his process or style or sense of the absurd, and this is reflected in Andersson's discussion of his influences, rarely ever citing other filmmakers. Instead, he speaks of painting and the history of art. When you watch Andersson's films, this makes complete sense, especially with his most acclaimed collection of cinematic paintings, The Living Trilogy, which includes Songs from the Second Floor, You the Living, and A Pigeon Sat on a Branch Reflecting on Existence. These films are made up of perfectly composed scenes, which we only ever see from a single deliberate angle. The viewer's eye is not governed by cuts, close-ups, or kinetic camera work. Rather, you explore each scene in the same way you would a painting in a gallery, with your own sense of time and attention. I want to inspect Andersson's painterly influences and how they inform his distinctive style, and why this establishes him as one of the most singular artists to ever work on the cinema's canvas. When interviewed about the final entry in his Living Trilogy, Andersson cites The Hunters in the Snow by Peter Bruegel as a primary influence. At first glance, this might not be clear, but the 1565 oil painting by the Dutch Renaissance artist echoes many of Andersson's aesthetic and thematic occupations. In the foreground is a scene of drudgery and the everyday labours of man. A hunting party returns from what was clearly an unsuccessful trip. To the left of them, a group tends to an open flame. And then, prominently, in the distance, there is a whole society of silhouettes skating on a frozen lake, unconcerned and unaware of the struggle depicted in the foreground. Andersson's worldview is similar. Like a painting, his screen reveals everything in the same focus. The background and the foreground are just as clear as each other. And he's interested in ordinary people too, struggling and failing, while in the background, a larger world skates on. Andersson also cribs from Bruegel's colour scheme. His colours are complementary in their muted melancholy, the people are faceless and the trees are bare. The colours in the Living Trilogy aren't so much muted as they have taken a strict vow of silence. The characters' costumes are chosen to complement the colours of the walls as if, at any moment, these figures might fade into their immediate environment. Andersson also emulates Bruegel and the larger body of Renaissance artists by giving his scenes a strong sense of centrality. Our initial gaze is guided towards a middle moment. Where Andersson is uniquely cinematic, though, is how he chooses to reveal elements, letting hidden aspects emerge in time. But they've always been there, and this mimics the way we find hidden details in paintings as we spend more time in contemplation of them. Bruegel was famous for his refusal to paint figures in accordance with urban standards of beauty. He was more interested in peasants than the aristocracy, and as far as we know, didn't paint a single nude. And Andersson is similarly uncompromising, not just in his insistence on using ordinary-looking people in his films, but also in his process as a whole. It takes him up to 4 years to make a single one of his films, and is nearly entirely self-funded. Most remarkably of all, nearly everything, from the carpets to the cityscape backdrops, are created on set. Andersson works with a committed team to create nearly every scene in studio, a painstaking but essential process. This is what gives every shot such a strong sense of composition. There isn't a ray of sunshine or a puddle that is there by accident. Bruegel was also known for his unique approach to religious scenes. This is the procession to Calvary, which depicts Christ on his way to the crucifixion. But you'd be forgiven for not realizing that at first glance. Christ, with the cross on his back, is just one of 100 figures in this scene. most of which are blithely unaware that one of the most important moments in history is occurring in their admittedly crowded midst. This is a remarkable painting, not just for the obvious skill in its creation, but in its perspective. It's a democratic vision of a world where everyone, from the Son of God to a humble travelling musician, are all equal parts of society. And also that for most of us, history is just something that happens in the background. When it comes to religion, Andersson takes a more directly satirical approach. This scene in Songs from the Second Floor reflects modern interpretations of Bruegel's religious work that see it as a sidelining of religion's importance. The crucifixion is an object of fixation throughout Songs from the Second Floor, presented mostly as a tacky consumer item. And this scene plays like a parody of a Renaissance devotional painting. What could be a martyred saint surrounded by witnesses is a man with his fingers caught in the door of a train. It is a satirical interplay between the sacred and the mundane. Like Bruegel, Andersson invites us to explore his work on our own terms. They are meticulously composed societies that patiently wait for the eyes of attentive viewers. But they can also be absorbed as a whole, as overwhelming portrayals of life as it's lived. And it is with this realism that we approach the most obvious of Andersson's aesthetic influences, Edward Hopper. Edward Hopper's lonely vision of America is instantly recognizable to anyone who has even a cursory interest in images. Hopper's world is one of beguiling contradiction. His scenes are sterile but emotionally vibrant, artificial but real, empty yet filled with meaning, and this sense of contradiction is alive in Andersson's best work too. He borrows Hopper's aesthetic brazenly, especially in scenes set in cafes and bars. It's easy to see the influence of Nighthawks in particular, with his isolated patrons and artificial lighting. Then there are scenes like this, of people alone in their bedrooms in solemn contemplation, reminiscent of Hopper figures like his pensive woman in pink. The people in Hopper's paintings are frequently bathed in artificial light. Likewise, Andersson's characters never have any shadows to hide in. They are exposed, naked in the fluorescence of an unfeeling modern world. Hopper captures instances of furtive feeling, where vacant physical space mirrors the isolation that his characters seem to be ruminating within. Andersson's characters too pine for a connection. In this scene from You the Living, it feels as if the girl from Hopper's automat is speaking directly to us, without ever leaving the confines of her frame. Both artists give us moments that have occurred in the aftermath or in the lead up to a significant event. Andersson himself points to The Office at Night by Hopper, with its two figures caught in an uncertain moment. He says that the painting is about waiting, but that it's almost moving. It's a kind of movie. And there's a definite truth to this. There is an undeniable, scenic quality to all of Hopper's paintings that make them feel cinematic. What may seem like a woman sat alone in a cafe is so much more than that, even if whatever that more is cannot be directly articulated. Hopper depicts huge personal events, they just occur in the inaccessible depths of a stranger's mind. Andersson also makes use of this kind of suggestion. Many scenes are plagued by what is happening between moments or by what is happening just out of view. It's up to the viewer to either imagine what is happening or amuse themselves with the mystery. Where Hopper and Andersson depart, however, is in tone. Hopper is an observant, deeply felt artist, but he's quite serious in his observations. Whereas Andersson is a satirist, with a taste for the grotesque. To find his kindred spirits in this respect, we have to look to the artists of the German New Objectivity movement. The New Objectivity was in many ways a revolt against Expressionism. Rejecting the idealist and romantic tendencies of the 19th century in favour of the bizarre and the satirical. The movement had its heyday in the Weimar Republic, and it was a wide church, housing contrasting artists, styles, and politics. But there are three artists in particular that Andersson cites as influences, borrowing his apocalyptic surrealism from George Gersh, his style of portraiture from Otto Griebel, and the grotesque from Otto Dix. The two Ottos produced portraits of ordinary people that were unflinching, their surroundings often informing and becoming a part of the people they were painting. The pale, grim faces they exhibited appear throughout Andersson's work, with many of his performers wearing makeup to give them a perpetually ashen look. It's a world of sad clowns in ill-fitting suits. The reality that the new objectivity aimed for had nothing to do with mimicking the real world we see with our eyes. Rather, it was found in the confrontation of society, its daily failings and indignities. These were artists who had seen war and were living in extremely troubled times that promised no improvement. Societal trauma and collective violence are constant themes in all of their work. Andersson, of course, does not share these artists' direct experience, but he's still fascinated by the spectres of that same violence. In Songs from the Second Floor, he depicts these spectres literally walking among us, stalking us even. The past here is not something we can escape, but nor is it something we can confront or change, or even take responsibility for. Andersson brings uncomfortable attention to this in his treatment of Europe's history of colonial violence, particularly in this uncomfortable and symbolic scene from A Pigeon Sat on a Branch Reflecting on Existence. Andersson brings the new objectivity's confrontational style to a modern audience. He is merciless in his criticism of consumer capitalism and how it atomizes and alienates us from one another. He has a nearly puritanical perspective when it comes to chastising modern society for its indifference to the suffering of others. It is comical, of course, but some might find the joke difficult to take because it's at all of our expense. But above all that, Andersson and the new objectivity artists are intensely humanistic. No matter how mundane our lives may be, no matter how separate we have made ourselves from our fellow man, we all have a soul that sings out together in a common cry. Andersson gives us the bleak and the beautiful, the everyday and the absurd, the sacred and the profane. He has said that his films are about what it is like to be a human being, a lofty ambition to be sure, but one I believe he achieves with the same success as the master painters from whom he borrowed his paint.